Why? Welcome to this video. We are going to talk about the Novation Base Station 2 analog synthesizer. Now, I've had this synthesizer for about 3 weeks now. I'm having a lot of fun with it. In this video, I'm going to talk about each section in detail. Now, if you want a specific section, you can look down in the description below and I will timestamp everything so you can jump to the relevant bit of information you want. So should we talk about build quality first? Now, if you're going to pay the full asking price, I think you're going to be very happy. Although it's plastic, it's extremely sturdy for the money. Just to give you an idea, if I drop this, say, from waist height onto my carpet, it's quite a short pile carpet. I don't think I'd damage it whatsoever. Okay, you might get a crack if you use concrete or something. If you're going to be gigging with it, I don't think you're going to run into any problems as long as you keep it boxed. What is good is the encoders are bolted to this top of the synth, and there seems to be a metal box inside holding the components. I don't know if you can just see that actually. I'll be able to see the bolts there, but what that means is you can get quite vigorous with the encoders and not worrying about them doing any damage to the circuit board below. As is the switches and the sliders feel all very solid. They don't feel like toyish at all. So that's good news. You've got these nice rubberized mod wheel and pitch, and you can go through the different octaves with these keys. And what's nice, a little touch here is like you press them both together, you get straight back to middle C. Yes, I know a lot of controller keyboards have that already, but it's something that they miss on some synthesizers. My Sub 30 from Moog doesn't have this, and it's just little things like that that make moving around a bit faster. So on the whole, build quality is excellent for the money. On the back, we've got MIDI in and out. We've got USB. This can be bus powered, but it also deals with MIDI. We've got a selectable switch between DC and USB. Now, you do get a power pack with this synth. You've also got a sustain in for a sustain pedal. You've got external in for an external source, so you can use an external source as an oscillator. You've got mono out, and also you've got your headphones. So that's build quality and the structure dealt with. Let's talk about the signal path. So it's a, actually, before we do that, we'll talk about bus power. Now, it says in the manual that USB hubs vary in quality, and I found this to be true. So if you've got a cheap laptop, perhaps it might not power very well off it, but I found off my 2011 iMac that it is very solid. Also off my 3-year-old PC that I built, where you do run into problems are if you're using things like unpowered USB hubs. I've got an unpowered USB hub in my Mac at the moment. I plugged it into that, and you just, although it powers on, it quickly gets to a state where it just gives you random values and it's not very stable at all. So bear that in mind if your USB ports aren't that reliable. Okay, so signal path, it's a 2 oscillator synth with a third sub oscillator. That's switchable here between the two, but the parameters are the same for both. The sub oscillator goes 1 and 2 octaves below oscillator 1, which is a nice feature, and also what I found is an excellent feature for layering sounds in a more convenient way, or more constructive way, let's say, is you get a choice of sub oscillators. You can have a nice sine wave for laying some sub bass. You can fatten a sound with a skinny pulse or a square. A lot of scope there with sub oscillator. You've also got this mix section. You can mix in noise, you can mix in noise ring modulation. Noise is what, just white noise, by the way. And you can set the level for the external source. Now, what is nice here is they've given you in the function menu, you can actually add input gain to your source. So if you're using something like an iPad, which is, hasn't got enough juice, enough volume even to run into this successfully, then you can add gain to your input signal, although it does distort quite quickly if you're not careful what you're doing. So once you set your input gain, then you can find your level. Now, you've got 2 filters on this synth. You've got the classic base station filter, and this is a multi-mode filter. You've got low pass, band pass, and high pass. You've also got the choice of 12 or 24 decibels per octave, and you've also got this acid filter, which I don't think needs to be there, but it adds a little something, and it does give you a more traditional rubbery acid sound, where, as I find, the classic gives you a bit more of that higher states of consciousness kind of acid, because obviously this low pass filter can self resonate and give you that extra scream that you might want. However, for rubbery sounds and more traditional sort of square wave acid, the acid filter does the job. You're probably best off skipping to the arpeggiator section if you want to hear that. Okay, moving over, we've got glide time, fairly self-explanatory. We've got 2 LFOs. Now, LFO1 deals solely with pitch, and LFO2 deals with pulse width modulation and frequency cutoff. We've also got 2 envelopes. There's not separated because there isn't room, but you can switch between 2 or both together. Now, I found this quite an intuitive way of working, because you can quickly set up a shape with the amp and mod envelope and then switch to one of these. And then it sort of goes into a pickup mode where you have to move to the value you need, and then you can fine tune. And I found it very easy to work with, and I haven't found it a problem at all. In fact, in general, getting around this synth is a breeze. And you've got various triggering modes for that as well. You've got a distortion, which can get pretty hectic, but as with a distortion on most things, less is more, I find. It came across really badly in the early videos. I know Novation rushed them out, but the filter modulation is actually one of my favorite features on here, and it can be particularly nice if you've got a lot of resonance. And basically all that does is use oscillator 2 as a modulator for filter cutoff. Now over here we've got the arpeggiator section. We're going to that into detail later, but there is also a step sequencer in there that is, by the sounds of it, pretty similar to the SH-101 by Roland. I've never used one, but it sounds as if it's the same kind of deal. It's very quick to use and easy. Now below that we've got these functions, function keys, which I found a bit of a headache on my sub Fatty without using the editor, but on here it's implemented extremely well, and it's extremely easy to use and find out what's on, what's off, what values of things are happening. So it's just a case of looking across here at the different tabs, finding the tab you want, pressing the function key, pressing the key, and then you can change the value of stuff while playing. So you never have to sort of guess at a value, so it's really easy to use. Now, before we go on to oscillators, if we just look at the master section over here, we've got a volume pot rather than an encoder, I believe. And we'll just look at how you save patches. You just literally press save, and then you can save in the position you're at, override the patch, or you can move to one of the 128 locations, and then you just press save again, you get an animation, and that is the patch saved. Now what's also great is you can dump your sounds to some software you might be using, or your DAW, and that's very simple. You just press your finger on the function key, as is with any of the functions. You go along to the global menu, go to dump, press the key, and you can have one, or you can dump the whole bank. And to send that, you just keep your finger on function and press dump again. And it's very simple also to load patches from your computer. You just play the MIDI file or send it from your MIDI utility application. The base station screen will flash, and then you can just either save in the location you're already at or scroll to one of the 128 patches, and it's job done. Same with sending a bank. So I believe that's all the rudimentary stuff. Now I'll just have a quick talk about how digital controls relate to an analog synth, because when you save a patch, if you move on to another patch, the direction of the encoder is not always going to be pointing at the value of the parameter that the patch was saved in. So to give you an example, if we go to patch 49, say we've made a patch and the oscillator for oscillator 1, of course tuning happens to be at 12, and we save that patch. Now we go over to 50, I've saved an initialization patch in here, so I already know that the course tuning will be at 0. So first of all, we might want to find out what the value was of this patch before we start altering it. And if you move the encoder, we can see that these lights come on. We've got these two arrows, and if the arrow is pointing backwards, you need to go down with the encoder until the encoder goes out to reach the original value. So once we hit 0, the light goes out, and if we go below this value, the up arrow points, so we know we need to go forwards now. So that's how that's dealt with. Now another issue might be that, say we're on patch 49 and we saved over here again, and we go to patch 50, which is an init patch, we know it's 0. Now, because this encoder isn't reflecting the value of 0, when we now press a key, so we know at the moment that we've got zero for our coarse tuning. Now when we move this encoder, the pitch is suddenly going to jump. So we've suddenly got this jump. I've turned it to a value of 10. Now we've suddenly got that jump. Now this is one way of implementing how to deal with this problem, and I think Novation have chosen right here, because there's another method called pickup, which basically would involve you turning the encoder till you went past 0, which was the original value, and then you start affecting the sound, because the encoder now reflects the value displayed. So That's one way of doing it, and that's better for maybe for a live situation. But why I think Novation have chose wisely here is because you don't want to keep having to pick up values before you can start altering the sound. So I'm glad with what they've done there. You may prefer pickup, but I think the envelope here does utilize pickup if you're switching between amp and mod, and then you go to one of the individual ones. I think then you have to pick up the value. I seem to remember. So there we have it. That is the Base Station 2. Now I'm going to go, as I say, into each section in detail. So see you in another section. Bye. Hello. Now we're going to talk about the oscillators of the Base Station 2. There's primarily two oscillators, but you also get this third sub-oscillator over here. For each oscillator, there's coarse tuning, fine tuning. You can change the range, 8 foot, 4, 2, 16. Now you've got choice between waveforms. You've got this nice clean sine wave. We've got a triangle. We've got a saw. We've got a nice sounding square. Very nice. Now you can select between the primary oscillators with this switch here, 1 and 2, and all the controls are the same for each. Over here we've got the amount of modulation envelope that is applied to pitch, so we can dial that in, which will basically send the modulation envelope over here over to pitch. And you can also dial in the LFO depth as well. Now you are going to LFOs later, but LFO1 deals exclusively with pitch and nothing else. You've also got pulse width modulation over here for modulating the square wave. I'll go into that in a sec. And you've also got this sync function. Now you do have some functions as well. If you look across the top here at the function tabs, we can go straight to oscillator here, and we can change the pitch range of the pitch wheel. And also this is where we turn sync on. And there are some modulations that can be applied by the modulation wheel over here that relate to pitch, but we'll go into those in a moment. Now let's look at the pulse width modulation. Now there's a selectable switch here, so if we're in the manual position, we can change the pulse width manually. And what that is doing is basically broadening and narrowing the square wave. You can modulate this with the envelope. So if we go over to modulation envelope, we can now hear that modulated. So we're dialing some pulse width modulation. Hopefully you can hear that. Okay, we could also modulate it with LFO 2. Now I'll go into LFOs later, but suffice to say that this is free running, it's not synced, and we're on a triangle at the moment. So we're dialing some pulse width modulation. And there we go, and there's LFO 2 modulating pitch. So I suppose we should look at sync before we go to the other functions. So I'll just initialize the patch again. Now, I won't go into a full explanation of sync. Suffice to say that if you want to listen to some, go and listen to some early 90s Prodigy music, the Prodigy, and you'll hear lots of lead lines with sync in it. It's a very cutting sound. It's great for leads because it cuts through a mix. I can show you the diagram in the Novation manual here. But it basically uses one oscillator to modulate another, and basically restarts the modulated waveform, modulated oscillator's waveform. In this case, oscillator 1 restarts the cycle of oscillator 2. It's probably better heard than explained, to be quite honest. So just in case when I'm showing you I don't get there very well, this is a patch I made earlier. It's like Blue Peter, this is one I made earlier, and it's this sort of sound. So it's very, can be very aggressive anyway. So let's have a go at doing a sync. Now it tells you in the manual that it's best to take oscillator one out of the mix as it's the modulator, and they're probably right there. So we're just listening to oscillator two at the moment. We go over here to the function menu and we look along the top for oscillators, and we can click oscillator one and two sync, and we press that. Then we get a flashing light over here and we can switch that on and off with the patch cursor. So you want it on, just press the function key again to exit. And now you can see the lights come on for sync mode. So let's just get a shape for oscillator two first. Let's go to a square wave and dial in some modulation, some envelope onto the pitch. And we're only listening to oscillator two. And we go over to oscillator one. So we're not hearing oscillator one or altering oscillator one audibly, but it is affecting the modulation of the pitch of oscillator two. And you can start, but basically the two things that have a bearing on what the sync sounds like are the tuning of and the modulations of one and two's pitch. Okay, so that's not the best sync sound in the world, and that went pretty badly, but let's have another go. Oh, helps if you put sync on, doesn't it? Kind of get a more pleasing sound if you modulate the pitches of both of the oscillators in sync, because they have more of an effect on each other, basically. Anyway, so that's sync. Now, the last section's to do with oscillators along the function here, so we go over and we can see oscillator, we've dealt with the sync function. We can also change the bit pitch range over here, and at the moment it's at 12, but we can have less of a pitch change, like so. Now we can also, with the mod wheel, send LFO 1 to pitch instead of sending it over here. We can add pitch whenever we need it. At the moment it's set to 10, so you'll get a sort of vibrato effect. But we can have more extreme values, or indeed negative values. Let's put it on. Like so. We can also affect just oscillator 2's pitch. So we take oscillator 1 out here and just have oscillator 2. And then we go over here and we can now dial in perhaps a negative value. And then we move the modulation wheel forward. It will send oscillator 2's pitch downwards. If you bring an oscillator 1. They can have interesting effects depending on how oscillator 1 is tuned. Let's come out there. And the last ways we can modulate the oscillators is with what's called aftertouch. Now, if you don't know what aftertouch is, it's basically the amount of pressure that's applied to the key once you've put a note on. So we can go over here, press function. And the first one is, well, the only one, in fact, is LFO1 to pitch again. So we can do, instead of using the mod wheel, we can also do it with how much pressure we put on the key. Like so. So that's a light key press, not putting any pressure down. And then we can get other vibrato effects by pressing the key. And again, we can also have negative values. Put it back onto back onto ramp for that. And that's it. So that's basically oscillators. But the last thing, of course, is the sub oscillator here. And that is tuning is dependent on oscillator 1's. So let's take all the everything out of the mix and just have the sub oscillator in. So you've got, again, the same way. So nice, this nice clean... nice clean sine wave that is really great on the bass station. You get some really nice sub bass out of this synth. And then you've got this narrow pulse, which is usually better at one octave below, just for fattening up a sound. And we've got this nice square. So that's the point. So if we dial in the oscillators, let's just dial in a quick sound. And then you can hear, as we bring in the sub oscillator, we bring it in on a narrow pulse. Just adding some nice tight sound, or maybe something a bit more drastic. And it really fattens things up. Right, we're going to take a look at the mixer section now. In the mixer section, we've got the volume for each of the oscillators. So 1. And we can dial in 2. Just detune that to make it more obvious. We can also dial in the sub oscillator as well. Now over here we have a volume control that is covers three different sources that are selectable with this switch. Now the first one, if we just take all these out, is white noise. Sounds like this. Now white noise can be used for percussive sound, wind sounds. It can also be mixed in with filter modulation to add attack and wisps and stuff to sounds. I've also got ring modulation. Now I'm not sure on the technicalities of ring modulation. A vague memory is it's the difference between the waves of the two oscillators, but I'll let you look that up on the net or something. So it's best heard on one oscillator probably. So we switch it to ring modulation and it sounds like this. Like so. Now the third input source in the mixer section is the external input. So whatever you've got coming in, you can go over to the external input section At the end of this video, if you want to see how that's done, basically you can dial in the level. You can also add some gain over here, as I explained earlier. You can add some input gain if your source hasn't got enough volume. And that is basically the mixer section. Okay, so the filter on the base station 2 is selectable between two different types. We have got the classic type, which is supposed to represent the original from the, I think it was 1993, the original base station. So in classic mode, we've got low pass, we've got band pass, and we've got high pass selectable between 12 and 24 decibels per octave. And we've also got a second filter called the acid filter, which I imagine is supposed to represent Roland's TB-303 type filter. Now, let's just get a sound in. If we can, for some reason we have no sound because I haven't got record on my... There we go. Right. So let's go to oscillator 2. Okay, so let's hear the filters. We've got also got drive over here, so you can add some drive pre-filter. So we have a bit of that in as well, actually. Had a bit of resonance. And we saved the filter. Okay, and on 12, you'll hear a smoother curve. And also with the low pass filter, if we just take out the oscillators, you'll be able to hear it. You can self-oscillating. It goes pretty high, and you might be able to hear it this low, probably. So that is itself oscillating. Now let's listen to the bandpass. We need some oscillators for this, don't we? And in 12. Back to 24. Now we've also got a high pass filter here as well. And I really like the high pass filter on this, it's excellent for getting some vowel sounds. So I'm just going to turn down the base station, I think hopefully we haven't clipped there. Okay, so that's the basic filter modes. You have also got this acid filter. Now, the acid filter is locked to 24 decibels per octave. And now, I said originally that I wasn't too keen on this filter. I should clarify that while it does sound acid, it's got that rubbery, acidy sound. You can get the classic 24 decibel to a scream a bit more, I suppose, and that's the kind of acid I like. I do like my rubbery square waves too, but I just found that I wouldn't have missed the acid filter, to be honest. I would have preferred some sort of different function. This was the money to be spent elsewhere, but that's just me. Okay, so I'll show you the acid filter in a moment because it's probably best heard on a sequence rather than just plain notes, but so let's modulate these filters, yeah. So over here, you can send the envelope to filter cutoff, but you can also send LFO 2 to filter cutoff as well. So let's just put in some filter. A bit of distortion as well. And then now we can, and now we can add some envelope depth and change the shape of the envelope. Thank you. have negative values as well, of course. So that's envelope. You can also modulate it, of course, with the LFO2. Okay, we're not synced or anything, we're just free running. Anyway, you get the idea. So that's LFO2. Now, how else can we modulate the filter? Well, we can also go over to the modulation wheel and modulate it there. So we just press function and filter, and then if we've got a mounted filter died in, I'll just take away that pitch modulation there, so it doesn't complicate matters. There we go. So we go press function, filter frequency, and now we can adjust cutoff. Rather than twisting the knob, we can do it at hand with modulation wheel. And of course, we can do negative values as well. Now, we can also do things like send LFOs, LFO to filter frequency. So that's basically sending LFO to the filter when we move the modulation wheel. So we're adding an amount there, but without any. We can also do negative values for that, I believe. So we can alter filter with those two functions with the pitch wheel, but we can also alter it with aftertouch as well. So we've got a tiny bit of opening the filter slightly there. We can have more drastic effects. As you can see. So I think that's everything actually. There are modulations on here that will affect the modulators. So if they're pointing in the direction of filter, you can get control that way as well. And I think that pretty much covers it. We're just going to go over to the acid filter, actually. And we can do a sequence with this. So if we just try it with a single square wave, we get maybe up a bit more. And if we just try a sequence, so switch on the arpeggiator, we're going to that later. Let's go to one of my previous sequences. I'm not really getting the best of sounds. If you go to my arpeggiator section, I've arpeggiated the acid filter in a bit more of a pleasing way, but you can get some nice sort of rubbery sounds out of it. Okay, But I find the Classic 24 decibel per octave filter, you can get the more squawks out of that. See what I mean? Perhaps with a bit more distortion, I can get. So that covers the filters. Hi, so on to the next section. We're going to look at modulations, and there are two modulators here. You've got two LFOs and we've got the envelope, so you've got two envelopes as well. Before we go on to that, we'll just look at this fellow here, which is the portamento time, and that is basically the time it takes from the pitch of your first note to reach to the next note played. So without any portamento, you'll just hear the direct bass sounds, bass frequencies of each note. And as we add glide time, it will take longer to climb through the frequency range to the next note played. So that's portamento. Let's look at the LFOs. There's two of these, and to demonstrate them, I'll just show you what LFO. I'll just demonstrate with LFO one. I've already explained that LFO one deals solely with pitch, and what LFO two deals with. So I won't go over that. But you have got this switch in the middle here. So when set to speed, you can change the speed of the LFO. So if we dial in some pitch modulation into oscillator one. Here I'm changing the pitch there. Now we can also change the waveform over here, so that's a triangle wave. We can also change to a ramp. Remember, we can dial in negative amounts as well to change the direction of the modulation. We can have a square wave. We can get sort of tremolo type sounds, although we can't modulate. Unfortunately, the amp can't be modulated by an LFO, which is a bit of a shame. I would have liked to have seen an LFO for the amp, but I suppose you can't have everything. And the last wave is sample and hold. Without going into the technicalities of this, it's basically a random waveform. So you get random, you get that kind of computer, that 70s film computer noise that you'll instantly know. There we go. I don't know what I just downloaded then. So you can also go to delay, and when you flick, actually, we just get more sensible modulation. What delay does with this synth, it works in different ways on different synths, but what it does on this synth is it's the amount of time it takes from when you press the key, the amount of time it takes for the modulation to intensify and resolve to, not resolve, but to reach its the maximum amount you've set by the LFO depth. So at a setting of zero, you'll just hear your modulation that you've set as normal. But at maximum, it will take longer and longer for the intensity to build up to that initial setting. So you'll hear it immediately, but you'll hear it drift in. It's basically like a fade. If you can think of it as a fade into the LFO setting that you have set. As you can see, it gets to the maximum amount that you've set by the LFO, one depth in this case. Now, I say it works in different ways because I think you can change the way that works on some synths. I know on some soft synths, it hasn't got such a fade to it. You can change the gradient, and some synths you can have it so it doesn't have any effect and suddenly comes in. But on this particular synth, it's you can think of it as just as a fader. For the LFO. Now, all those functions are the same for LFO too. And indeed, if we look at the function section, we can do more things with the LFO. So if we go along here and we look at the LFO one, we can see we can change the key sync, we can change the speed sync, and we can change what is called slew. Now, we can do all of those each for LFO1 and LFO2. Respectively for each of these, but I will just show you with LFO1 because it's the same for LFO2. So the first thing we're going to look at is key sync. Now, key sync, to show this, is probably best shown on a ramp wave, and it'd be more apparent. Actually, I've just changed the delay time, so we go to speed. And what this does, instead, if you can imagine the LFO wave of the ramp, in this case, going along, doing its cycle, whenever you press a note, this cycle is carrying on. So every time you press a note, it's hitting different points of the ramp. So sometimes it might be at the bottom of the ramp, sometimes it might be at the top, halfway down, two-thirds up. You're going to hit it at random points in the cycle of the wave. So you're going to get a different sound every time you press a key. So let's hear that. Slow it down. So it's you can kind of hear it there. It's hard to show because your brain naturally wants to hit it in time with it of the LFO, at least mine does. So you do kind of hit it at the same point every time. If I switch this function on, so if we go into the function keys and we go to LFO key sync for LFO1 is off. If I switch it on, you'll be able to hear what it does. So all that's doing, instead of hitting when you're pressing the key, the modulation starting from a random point in the cycle, every time, in this case we're using the ramp, is starting at the bottom of the ramp. So because we've got a negative depth going on, so it's going from the bottom of the ramp to the top, so it's increasing the pitch, in other words, every time from the same point. So you get, the point of that is you get a very uniform modulation to your sound. Where that is more important is in bass sounds, which is what this synth primarily deals with, and it's particularly useful when you're dealing with LFO modulations on the cutoff. And indeed, by default, I think the initialization patch has it off for LFO1 and on for LFO2. So that's what key sync does. We move over to speed sync. Hitting function and going to speed sync will display the speed. Now if we listen to the LFO and change the speed, we are changing random speeds, we're just going up and down the frequency in no particular fashion. Now if we go to the right, it will go to sync. So now the LFO is synced either to the tempo that you've set over here for the arpeggiator, or indeed if you've got it clocked to your door, like I have, which is at 120 BPM at the moment, we can now now when we turn this knob, it will instead of showing random numbers indicating what frequency you're at, it doesn't indicate what frequency you're at, but it's relative to a frequency. You're now changing through individual notes, so you know, dotted apes and what have you. So in other words, it's quantized to your project, and you would want that if you want a particular modulation to sync in rhythm with, say, a drum beat. Now, you can also do this for LFO 2, as I've mentioned. So we go on to the last function here, which is called SLU. Now, the best way I can describe SLU is... basically, what SLU does is it rounds off the edge of the waveform of the LFO. So if you've got a sharp triangle, it just takes off the top edge. And the way I think of it is being like a fine tune knob for the LFO depth. So you can set the depth of the LFO and the intensity of it, but you can't necessarily... the adjustment is too much. So if you want a lot of modulation going on, so we have a lot of modulation going on in the LFO one, a strong modulation of pitch, but we want to keep that intensity, but we just don't want the sharpness of that triangle. We can adjust that with the SLU, and it will basically take off the edge of that waveform. And like I say, it's just like a fine adjustment for the LFO depth. So let's hear that. We go to function, and we go to LFO, and then we go to SLU for LFO 1. And you can hear the effect it has as I dial in the amount of SLU we want. So you can hear what's happening there. I found this to be more useful at high frequency LFOs, high speeds, but particularly comes into its own when you want to modulate the filter very fast with LFOs to get a specific sound, and it gets very distorted and abrasive, and you can just smooth it off. In fact, we do that. So let's modulate the filter with an LFO. Why is that? Not too sure why. Nice sound. Right, so we've got that sound. Let's speed up. It's a pretty cool noise. Now, if we go to SLU now for LFO 2, we can now smooth that edge off. If we take it out, you can hear the harsh edge again. So no SLU. It's not the best noise to do on. take off the stute. I'll just take that off by going back to the initialization patch. So, but if we just did that with it's back to that sort of sound, but if we do that by taking out, instead of not using slew and just losing the LFO depth, which is what immediately comes to mind. So we lose it all too quick. We lose the power of the LFO. I mean, we're still getting interesting sounds, but it's a more subtle way of changing LFO depth, is the way I figure it. It might be something completely different technically, but this is how I found the best way to use slew. So that is LFOs. Okay, so let's look at the envelopes. There's two, but before we go into them, I'll just give a quick explanation of what an ADSR is. It's the attack, it's the decay, it's the sustain and the release of a sound, and it's probably best shown with an amp setting. Now, it's quite hard to explain, because but it's much easier to conceptualize in your own mind, but I'll have a go. The attack, we're just dealing with the amp here, so this refers to volume. Now, the attack is how quickly it takes for the sound to reach the volume that you've set the synthesizer at. So I've got no attack at the moment, so immediately you'll hear the volume of the synth. That's how loud the amp is at the moment. Now, if I increase attack, it will take longer from the point of zero, from no sound, to reach the level that I have set the synth at the amp at. So if we go to there, you can hear the volume fade up. So that fades the volume into the amp level that you've set. Now, the decay is slightly more complicated. It's basically, there's a better explanation in the manual, actually. Let's see what the manual says. It says it adjusts the time it takes for the volume to fall from its initial full volume to the level set by the sustain control while a key is held down. And that's the important part, while a key is held down. So if we have a very short short decay, if we have no sustain, so there's not going to be no sustain to the note, if we have a very short decay, you'll get this sort of sound. Because there's no sustain, so the sound decays very quickly because we haven't got much decay. So because we've got no sustain, there's no volume there, so it decays to no sound very quickly. As we add decay, it will take longer for the sound to drop to where the sustain level is at, which is at zero at the moment, which is basically no sound. So it's kind of almost doing it with the setup as we've got at the moment. It's doing opposite of what the attack was doing. So it's taking longer for the sound to drop, but it will eventually drop to where the sustain level is at with no sustain. Now, you can think of sustain as a volume control when dealing with the amp. So with no sustain, the sound is going to drop pretty sharply with not much decay to zero. As we add sustain, it's now falling to the point of where the sustain is. And as we raise the sustain, we will increase the volume. So in effect, it becomes a volume control. Now that is all while the note, while the key is pressed down. As soon as you let go of the key, you're going to get no volume. If you do want volume, when you let go of the key, you adjust the parameter called release. And as we add release, it basically increases the time it takes to drop back down to zero. So release times will obviously increase the time it takes for the sound to get to zero. So that's a very crude and not the best explanation of ADSL you're ever going to hear, but that's how it makes sense to me, and perhaps it will make sense to you. Right, so again, that can be applied to the modulation envelope, but instead of raising and lowering volumes, you might be increasing and decreasing pitch, or you might be opening and closing a filter knob instead, depending on what you have that modulation envelope directed towards. Now, you've only got one control of two envelopes, so Novation have got around this quite niftily, I think, because there just isn't the real estate on a small synth like this, and I haven't found it a problem. They've got this thing where they've combined the amp and the modulation envelope together, so you can go, you can initialize a patch and get a basic shape for a sound. Kind of make just dealing with the amp there because I haven't got any other modulations going on. But if I want to add some filter, I can. And if I want some modulation to complement that amp curve, I can dial it in now. So that's a basic sound. I've got a basic sound very quick, but it's not quite. I want that filter closing a little quicker, so I can then adjust the modulation envelope to complement the amp. And I can fine tune the amp if I'm not happy with that. Perhaps I want less sustain. And perhaps I want a quicker attack. So you can still make it sound pretty quick, and it isn't too much of a headache not having separate controls over the amp and the mod envelope. Okay, so let's move on to this fellow here, and this is the triggering mode, and basically this dictates how the envelope relates to how you're playing the keyboard. I'm not a keyboardist at all, I don't play the keyboard. But if you do play the keyboard, this is probably more relevant to you, although it is relevant to how you play certain sounds, especially bass sounds. So if we're on the first mode here, the multi-mode, let's just create a filter modulation with the envelope. So we'd just bring down the filter, add some modulation. In the overdrive and the resonance to make the sound more apparent. With multi-mode, if I hit a note and while my finger's still on it, I touch another note, it re-triggers the envelope from the beginning. If I take my hands off the keyboard, the envelope is always re-triggered anyway. Now in single mode, if I keep my finger on a note and then play subsequent notes, instead of the envelope re-triggering from the beginning, it just carries on playing to the end of the envelope. So if I happen to play a note in between the start of the envelope and say it's halfway through the envelope, it's just going to play the curve of the envelope at the point it's at. Eventually the envelope will finish and you'll just be playing where the envelope is finished. So that's pretty straightforward. Now auto glide, I shall read from the manual, I think. It's a better explanation. Oh no, I remember. Auto glide, basically what it does is if you play a note legato or smoothly together, so if you're sort of gliding from one note to the other, it will add some portamento time to your playing. So that's probably the simplest way of explaining it. So it's sort of an automatic portamento, I suppose. And that's pretty much the envelope section. While we're here at the envelope section, actually, I'll deal with things that relate to amp and velocity and what have you. So we go back down here to the function section, and if we go over to velocity, we can add, depending on how hard we hit the key, as opposed to aftertouch, which is how much pressure we put on the key, and keep the pressure and release the pressure. Velocity is similar, I suppose, but it's the it's a much quicker action, I suppose, is the best way to describe it. So if we get a function and press amp envelope, we can dial in how loudly the amp envelope is played. So if you have lots of velocity, we can play sounds softly and loudly. So if we have lots of velocity, we can play quiet, and the harder we hit, let's just have an amp envelope, shall we? So okay, so now we've got lots of we've got an amp envelope and we've dialed in. You can hear there's lots of difference between the softest and the hardest notes and the loudest notes depending on how hard I hit the key. I wonder if you can have that going in the opposite direction. Yeah, you can also have that in the opposite direction. So when you press the key gently, you'll get a loud note. And when you press it hard, you'll get a quieter note. Okay, so that is changing the amp envelope modulation with velocity. Now you can also do that for the filter envelope. So if we dial in an envelope for the filter, at the moment it doesn't matter how light or how hard we press the key, we're still getting the same modulation. Now if we press function and go over to velocity and press envelope amount, we can change how much modulation we have in respect to how hard we hit the key, as you'll hear. So I'm pressing it really lightly, we're not hearing much of that envelope being directed towards the filter, but as we press it harder, we hear more. And we've got a bit of aftertouch going on there as well, but you can hear velocity now modulates the filter envelope, and again you can have negative values for that. Now, moving along, we go to the VCA. Now, this is a limiter, and basically this is useful for sounds that may have, you might have a lot of resonance in them, and they may alter in volume drastically when you press a key. And sometimes, specifically with bass sounds, you may want a more regimented volume. So you either don't blow your speakers, or it just sounds nice in the mix. Now, limiters can vary in quality a great deal and can be musical, and they can just sound pretty harsh. And this is I'd rather personally be going, having the audio going through my door and using a software limiter, because it's not particularly pleasing. It does a job. It limits, but it's not, it does have a harsh effect on the sound. So let's dial in a really piercing sound, shall we? So if we want to let's add some velocity modulation as well. So So if we want that to be a more regimented sound, we can go to function, we can put on the limiter, and this is really more to protect your speakers from what I can make out. And we can dial in a limiter amount, and it will just basically stop the volume from going past a certain point, so you don't blow up your speakers basically. So now I can get reckless with the filter. And the limiter is always going to be there protecting. So if I take the limiter off and listen to that sound. It's not making much difference, is it? I've managed to make a pretty silly sound to show you. Let's just try it with so we had some limiter to that. See, it's just squashed the sound basically. So there's not a lot of modulations on the synth where things have got reckless and you'll get some spike in volume that I've come across. So I do question really them putting a limiter on there. I suppose it does no harm, really, to be honest. But a lot of synths don't have it, and we managed to not blow up our speakers. So there you go. So that is the BCAA limiter. And next, we're going to look at the ARP section, and then I'll do a separate little section on anything that I've left out, i.e. the global section, things like this transpose key. Okay, so what I didn't talk about in any of the sections was the effects, so we'll quickly do that now. So this. Use this sound. You can add distortion, which is basic distortion. It goes from adding some nice texture to the sound to completely splitting it apart. And it's quite pleasing at lower settings rather than completely getting silly with it. Next to that is oscillator filter modulation, and basically that is dials in an amount of how much the filter is modulated by oscillator number two. So the waveform of oscillator number two will modulate this filter cutoff. So by changing filter to oscillator to 2's pitch, etc., basically any modulation that is affecting oscillator 2 will have an effect on how the cutoff frequency is modulated. So let's see how this pans out. I found it's quite nice at high resonances as well, especially when the filter's self-oscillating, it tends to make quite pleasing noises. So let's just start with a patch of just oscillator 2, and there we have both oscillators, and we add some filter cutoff, and we're adding some actually, let's get this a bit louder. And now we're going to add some oscillator, some filter, no, some FM. So that's modulating the filter with oscillator 2. So let's modulate oscillator 2 and see what effect that has on the filter. So let's give oscillator 2 some pitch modulation with LFO 1. hear the filter is being battered about by the So that's FM modulation. Some bellish sort of noises. Some general mayhem as well. FM. On to the arpeggiator. Hi, we're going to talk about the arpeggiator section now. The arpeggiator section is here, and there are also some functions involved, swing and retriggering, which I shall explain later. First of all, we're over here, we go over to the tempo knob. Now, the tempo knob goes from 40 to 240 BPM, but all you'll see at the moment is 120 because it is locked to my Ableton Live at the moment's clock. So below that we have the on and off switch for turning the arpeggiator on and off. Next to that we have a latch which basically holds the MIDI note on like so. So without, okay, now you can also use that latch when you haven't got the arpeggiator on. I haven't got much sustain on this bass thing I've done, so you won't hear that, but you can kind of get the idea there. Now next to that you've got rhythms. Now rhythms are interesting. You get 32 of them, and rather than choosing the note division like eighth notes or quarter notes or whatever, you have to choose rhythms and how the timing of those relate to your BPM. So so it's not so traditional that you can choose the note divisions, but they are within three divisions of rhythms, basically. So I'll show you that in a moment. Next to that, you've got how the arpeggiation is played. So you've got up, you've got down, you've got up, down, you've got up, down, two, which I think just repeats some notes in the up and down progression. And you've also got played, which is how you, the order of the notes you played, and random, and so in not any particular order. You've also got this play and record, and that deals with the sequencer, which I'll go into later. While you're dealing with the arpeggiator, you can also change how many octaves are involved. One to four octaves can be involved. And there's also that also doubles up as the selection switch for the sequence memory. So let's listen to an arpeggiation and hear how the rhythms affect that. So we turn on the arpeggiator, we latch it. So we've just got an up pattern going at the moment, and we have two octaves involved. Then we hear a down pattern, so it's reversed, up and down, up and down two. Seems to repeat some notes, how I played it, and then randomly between the three notes that I played. Now let's listen to the different rhythms. So we can go, we're at 120 BPM. So I'm not going to go to every rhythm, but there's different rhythms within that quantization. And then we can go right up here. Okay, that's how the rhythms and the octaves work. So you can just go right up to four different octaves involved. Now, probably the more interesting section is the sequencer. And what you need to do this to record your sequence is, first of all, choose a rhythm, I suppose. And just use some straight notes. Then you need to decide which one of the four memories you want to record in. So actually, before we do that, you just need to turn this selection switch right the way around to record. So in record mode, then we can use this to decide which of the four locations, sequence 1, 2, 3, and 4, we want to record in. So we want to record into 1, say. So we're now ready to record. Now remember, the length of your note isn't recorded, just the note on data. And we can add legato and rest to the sequence over here. So we can press a note. That's recorded. We can tie that note to the next note played by pressing legato, and that tie will appear there. If we decide against not wanting a tie, we can take it out as well. And we can also add rests into the sequence. Right, when we're done inputting our notes, our legato and rests, we just switch this back to play. And now that sequence is recorded into position 1, and we can play this sequence across the keyboard. It's transposed across the keyboard. But not only that, so you can hear it's transposed, not only that, we can add one of the 32 rhythms to it. While I'm doing this, I'm just going to show you the acid filter, because I talked about that earlier and how I wasn't completely happy with it. But if I turn it over, you can hear that you get the nice tone of an acid filter. So you get the squidginess and the rubbery sort of acid sound, or at least with this square wave. But where I've felt that it, the Classic does better than that is you can get the real, you can really slide the resonance with the Legato and what have you with the Classic filter. It's just more pleasing for me, I think. It depends what sort of acid sound you're after, I guess. So I'm just demonstrating that there because it's more apparent when you're sequencing with the acid filter. So as you can hear, you get that resonance you might want from an acid sort of sound, but I suppose the acid filter is more traditional, and you do get the rubberiness with that. I suppose it just it's subjective and whatever you particularly like. So that's how the sequencer works. Obviously, I'm not a keyboard player, so if you know your scale structures and what have you, then programming a rhythm is going to be a lot more fun than those of us that don't play and have to do it randomly. But as you see, you can do a lot with a recorded sequence. You can add different rhythm structures to it, and you can do all the other arpeggiation functions, add more octaves, and the sequence in which it's played, just the rhythm, sorry. Now, the last bit of the arpeggiator is, we'll stay with what we did there. Now we can go over here and we can add some swing to it. So, as recorded, now we can swing that. I mean, that's a bit extreme, isn't it? You get the idea anyway. So we just take that out. But the last function there, let's come out of that. Right, the last function is re-triggering the sequence. Now, this is a bit harder to explain, so I'm going to just read what it says in the menu in a minute. But basically, it's because you've got different rhythm patterns, the sequence that you've made is not always going to fit logically into one of the rhythms. So basically what it does is re-triggers the sequence or arpeggiation every two bars. So in the manual, I believe it says the available rhythms as described in the arpeggiator section range from two bars of single crotchet beats to two bars with a complex pattern of semi-quaver beats. The number of notes in the rhythm pattern therefore varies from 8 two bars each of 4 crotchets to 32 two bars each of 16 semi-quaver rests. However, a recorded sequence could contain any number of notes up to a maximum of 32. Thus, the length of the sequence may not match the length of the selected rhythm pattern. This may be fine, but in some instances it may be better to shorten the sequence to match the length of the selected rhythm, i.e. to have a repetitive sequence matching the rhythm. So, when set to on, sequence re-triggers the sequence every two bars, irrespective of whether playback of the entire sequence has been completed. With sequence re-trig set to off, the sequence will be played in its entirety, even if it wraps around the rhythm pattern. So that might make more sense to you, but it basically, just remember, it re-triggers your sequence every two bars, I suppose. And that relates to rhythm, so I'll just switch that on. So without it on, let's go to an up. No, we have to be in sequence, so. And with it on, I don't know if the pattern's long enough for it to make any effect. So it's on at the moment, so if we turn it off, it may not sound so complimentary, I suppose. I suppose with a rhythm and beats involved, it'll be more apparent how that you need it to repeat. So that is basically the arpeggiate section. Hey there. In this last section, we're going to look at the remaining global functions in the function menu. We're also going to look at the transpose key. And more interestingly, we're going to look at the external input. So let's deal with the transpose keys first, shall we? So we've got the basic unit patch. Now, as I've said before, we can transpose up and down by octaves with the octave key, and then we can press them both together to get back to middle C. But we can also transpose in semitones. So to do that, we can press transpose here, and then we can choose a key, basically. So if we choose F sharp, middle C will now play F sharp instead. And to get back to C, we just press transpose again. Press C. Why you'd want to do that, I'm not too sure. Keyboardists will probably tell me. Perhaps you just want to transpose a sound into the area where you're playing the keys, or it may be a scaling thing. I have no idea. But that's how you do it anyhow. Now, in this last global section, we'll just go through the functions. We've got press function and MIDI channel. You can change which MIDI channel, which one of the 16 you want to have the bass station working with. You can also turn local on and off. Now, if you're not familiar with local, it basically deactivates the synth part from the keyboard. So you might want to do that if you're using it as a controller, and then you'd make a MIDI track for the bass station and direct that MIDI track at the bass station. So if you're using this in a DAW, you'll probably want to turn local off. The next function is tune, so that's the master tune. If you need to tune the synth to a certain piece of music or something. And input gain is for the incoming signal. If your device hasn't got enough gain in it that you're putting on the external input, you can add some here. I'm going to demonstrate in a minute with my iPad, so I'm going to need to give that a bit of makeup gain. And the last one we've dealt with right at the beginning, which is patch dump, basically for patching, for dumping a patch or the whole bank. So let's have a look at this external in. So usually when you've got an external, you're basically using an external source as an oscillator, so you need to be able to play that oscillator. So you have to have a key down to have an incoming source. Now, quite a few synths don't have a function for keeping the key down, so you end up doing things like this, putting clamps on them. But fortunately, with the base station, we've got this latch mode, so we can just latch on a key. Not function, we want latch. And you can hear that. Now I'm just going to take that oscillator out of the mix, so we've just got the external in. And now we put this mixer slider up to external in, and we can dial in an external source. We've got a bit of interference there, it's just coming from my iPad, but hopefully that will... I didn't have that before. Basically, I haven't got the best connection because I've only got a stereo jack, so I've done the old trick of only pushing in the stereo jack halfway so it becomes a mono. So hopefully that will still get sound from that. There we go. So let's choose a drum machine on the old iPad. I've got the Korg iElectribe. Electribes are great fun if you ever get to go on one. This is a little drum pattern I've made. It's a little drum bass pattern, and it sounds a bit crunchy to start off with anyway because I've added some bits of distortion within this. This is great little app, and you can add your own wallpaper to it as well, as you can see. So why have we got no sound? We shall find out in a moment. Perhaps I need to adjust this. There we go. Oh no, I don't need a mono lead. It's just it wouldn't give me a sound before. I thought I needed to have to use a mono. There you go. You can hear the drum pattern. I'll move this out of the way now. So we've got latch on, so we've latched a note on, so we've got a constant incoming signal, so now we can adjust maybe the filter, get some resonance, then we can maybe get an LFO and try and get that in time, shall we? and add your distortion. Add your filter, FM, FO drive, change the filter. General idea. Just change the patch again so we don't think of that interference. No, it doesn't function well actually. And we just set it up for external source. Now if I change to something like Sunriser Synth for instance, I'll go to a little patch I've made, a little patch called Sympathy, which is just a pad. Wow, that's loads of distortion. It doesn't usually sound like that. That's maybe because I've got added some input gain earlier. Did we? Yeah. So this is usually at 10, the input gain, which you can hear. So I wanted to show you. It's really quiet for the. I've got my iPad maxed out, so I need to add some input gain. We don't want it distorting too much, so we'll see how we go. If you add too much, it distorts quite badly, so. We want enough so we can hear something, so there we go. So unfortunately, I don't think there's a latch key on the old Sunriser Synth. So I just have to play it over here. Using a synth on our iPad and modulating it with the base station. Get some distortion. Again, we can use all the modulations we've got available to us. And it's as simple as that. So that is everything now, I believe. Space Station 2, it's all of its functions. I know I've rambled in some areas. Hopefully it's helpful to somebody who's a complete novice, which isn't far off me, to be honest. But hopefully even if you've got a bit more experience, I've given you some idea of the functionality. As you see, it's quite a basic synth, but there's a lot on it and there's a lot of sound potential. I'm just going to do the last video of some patches I've made in a moment to obviously had time to make rather than sort of rushing things here. So thanks for watching and total thumbs up for the Base Station 2. I think it is well worth its money and I am well chuffed with it. See you later.